Got your email?
Oh, yeah. I thought it might be of interest. I don't know.
No, yeah, for sure. No, for sure, definitely. Do you expect some public comment on it?
Yeah, I think so. I do. Yeah.
Cool.
It's nice. I'm a Pomeroy Terrace resident.
All right. That's great. Thanks for letting me know.
Yeah, thank you.
This is the November 15th, 2016 meeting of the Northampton Transportation and Parking Commission. My name is Ryan O'Donnell, the chair of the commission. I note the presence of a quorum, so I will call the meeting to order. And the first thing I'll do is announce the audio and video recording of these proceedings. And I would like to begin, as is our habit, with introductions for the benefit of the public, and in case we have forgotten who we are, starting with our budget.
I'm Julie Shara. I'm the ward for City Council.
Dave Pomerantz, Director of Central Services.
Jody Casper, Chief of Police.
Rich Cooper, Citizen.
Donald Scalia, DPW Director.
Jamie Fisher, Citizen.
Devin Bruce from the Planning Board.
Nancy Forrestall, Assistant City Collector.
Maggie Chan, DPW.
Terry Ushko, DPW.
Okay, thank you very much. We always begin every meeting with a period of public comments, an opportunity for members of the public to speak on any issue you wish. Generally, we also say you can speak again if the agenda item you're interested in appears later in the agenda, but feel free to do either or both. The only thing is, in this part, we don't really engage in a back and forth. It's your time to express your thoughts to us. So with that, is there any member of the public who'd like to speak on any subject, which is in there?
Yeah.
And if you would give your name and address for the record.
My name is Fred Zimnock. I live at 23 Pomeroy Terrace. And I live basically between Bridge Street and Phillips Street. And I'd like to talk about the escape route on Phillips Place. And I think you prepared some pictures for me.
Yeah, members of the commission have the pictures you email.
Okay.
There should be copies for the public too.
I spoke to the TPC three times in 2011. About the problem of using Phillips Place as an escape route, and there were no results. At the time, Councilor Tacey was chair. Councilor Freeman Daniels was a member, along with DPW Director Ned Huntley, Police Chief Russell Sinkovich, DPW Traffic Engineer Laura Hanson. Actually, they did decide to move the utility pole at Palmeri Terrace and Phillips Place, but that has never happened. The route is definitely a poor choice in winter when electricity and emergency service are of paramount importance. The turn from Phillips and Palmeri is difficult without snow. Maria Tanasco, the Ward 3 City Councilor, recalled during her term in office that at the corner, a no parking sign was destroyed, utility pole and curbing was damaged. Utility pole, which supports many lines that are generally important in the winter, still carries and receives more abrasions from the trucks that make the corner. If you look at the first photo, and I don't know what you got for photos, but there's a photo of the Palmeri Terrace Phillips Place corner. It's a faraway scene of the utility pole. If you look at the curbing and the sidewalk, which was recently put in place, you'll see that it's very damaged. And the trucks, even without snow, can't make that turn. They hit the curbs and also the utility pole. The second photo shows damage to the utility pole. It's a close-up of the utility pole. You can see that there are abrasions on the utility pole. Also, the grounding strap on the utility pole has been damaged. The insulating on that grounding strap has been pulled away. And I'm not sure what happens if that grounding strap breaks, but anyway, I don't think it should be damaged. There's also a third photo that shows that corner in the winter time. And you can see the problem the trucks have in the winter time. They again try to make that turn. Now there's a snow bank in place, and they run over the snow bank, and the wheels of the back of the truck, the back carriage of wheels, get hooked on a snow bank, and they get stuck. My experience is when there's snow, they usually get stuck at that intersection three or four times a year. But I don't know the exact number. Of course, if there's no snow, there's no problem. The fourth photograph shows the police helping release a truck from the snow. The truck, and during the 2011 TPC discussions, when I showed that photo, Police Chief Russell Sienkiewicz said that it was definitely a safety problem. The fifth photo shows winter parking on Phillips Street, which would be impossible for a truck to maneuver. The Northampton Fire Department ambulance and fire trucks are 8.4 feet wide. My car often just about makes it down that street, and it's about 6 feet wide. So an ambulance or a truck, a fire truck, is not going down that street. During the summer, I spoke to, first of all, I noticed in our city ordinance 312-27, General Prohibitions, Section F, it reads, upon any roadway where the parking of a vehicle will not leave a clear and unobstructed lane of at least 12 feet wide for passing traffic. So basically, if you look at that picture of the cars on Phillips Place in the winter, those cars, I would assume, are all illegally parked. And I spoke to Nancy Forrestal during the year, and I showed you that picture, and you told me that if I see that, I should notify you or the DPW that the street should be closed.
Not closed.
But you told me that I should notify you.
Right.
And something should be done about it. I also suggest that if you're going to change the escape route, you talk to Michael R. Sensetti, managing member of New England Urban Senior Living Center, who's going to put up a development, the senior development at Holly Street. Additionally, I've noticed occasions when the railroad bridge warning lights are flashing and there's no truck. I've also noticed a truck going towards the bridge when no warning lights are flashing, and the truck driver immediately takes a turn on Strong Avenue. Are the warning lights working? When were they last tested? I think that should be answered. An additional issue you might want to consider is the Route 91 exit 19. I was at the design meetings for exit 19, and there was consideration given to truck escape in the rotary. So it's built into that design spec. So that ought to be considered. I don't understand what this proposed legislation will accomplish. My understanding or my feeling is that this legislation should promote trucks from going down Bridge Street. And I don't see how closing the Lincoln Avenue escape route will help. I can only stay till 5 o'clock. Maybe I'll learn what that means. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Is there anyone else who'd like to give public comment at this point? Councilor Nash?
Hello, everybody. My name is Jim Nash, City Councilor from Ward 3. First of all, I want to thank everybody for your concern about this issue. I think it's great that a discussion is happening and that a possible plan is coming forward. So thank you for doing that. I want you to know that as I ran for election, this was the number one thing that I told people I was going to work on. And I just learned about this proposal over the weekend, and that I'd like, so, you know, that in terms of what gets presented today, I haven't seen the plan. I'm interested in seeing what it is. I would like some time to understand the plan and also go back to my constituents and get an idea of what would work for them. I'm here to listen and hear what you guys have to say. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And we're just going to pass up some extra agendas and packets. So if anyone hasn't seen the details, then they can, you can see them now. And we'll also be discussing them later in the agenda. Is there anyone else who'd like to give public comments?
Good afternoon. Joel Squires, 38 Lincoln Avenue. I've been before this committee many times. During Halloween this past year, we probably had 6 trucks in a 2-hour period while the kids were trick-or-treating on Lincoln Avenue. Very dangerous. I spoke with Mayor Narkowitz 6-7 weeks ago, trying to get a meeting with Coca-Cola. He took my phone number, email address. To this present time, I have not heard back from him. I've said this before, it's a disaster. I think we need to get together with Coca-Cola so we can try to solve this problem. Most of these trucks are going to Coke. They don't seem to be helping us. In 1995, when Coke was granted their special permit, it states right here, all truck traffic to, from the site will use Industrial Drive. No additional truck traffic will be generated on North Street or Day Avenue, southeast of the site, since Bates Street to the south of Bradford Street is a truck exclusion. With signs posting that trucks are prohibited. I don't know what else to say. I've been to this meeting many, many times. There doesn't seem to be any solutions going on. It's terrible. I mean, 15 trucks a day come down my street. And now you want to ship them down to Phillips Place? I don't think that's going to work either. What about down by the Sheldon Field or turn around down there or something? Better signage coming off the highway, meetings with Coca-Cola, anything. Thank you.
Thank you. Is anyone else would like to?
Mike Kirby, formerly of North Street, now of 212 Prospect Street. I too have seen the trucks go, and there's really no excuse for trucks getting any closer to downtown than the field, the old ferry road, is it, that goes to the airport? Is it old ferry or? Yeah, but anyway. And I think that idea has been kicked around a good deal in other years. But essentially, there's no clearance, there's not adequate clearance on those streets when you get close to downtown. It's a miracle we haven't had really serious problems. So I urge you to look at a different alternative that keeps the trucks away from downtown. And I think a turnaround could be arranged with the help of the Three County Fair. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anyone else this time? Okay. There'll be opportunity for more discussion later. So we'll close public comment for now. And just to go through some of the items that we have to take care of. Approval of minutes in previous meeting. Those are not available yet, so without objection, I think we can postpone to the next meeting. Reports from departments, including the DPW. Any DPW updates to share?
There will be sidewalk inventory. They will be collecting data for another 3 weeks, and then after that, they will start processing the data and analyzing it for where the sidewalk gaps are. To get a recommendation. Pavement management, we have BHP survey a quarter of the city streets. They do this annually. And then
Can you speak up?
So BHP pavement management, we have BHP as our consultant to survey a quarter of the streets annually. And when they update the database, we get the pavement condition, and using that, we can start looking at next year's pavement contract. Traffic calming, Nonotuck Street, the temporary speed humps were removed. I'll be writing a memo on the trial results. The paving contract is again doing punch list items, some more signage will be put up at various locations.
Okay, thank you. Any questions from the commission for DPW? May I ask a question? Do you know when you might expect the Federal Street traffic calming study? Much anticipated. If you live on Federal Street.
Right. Yes. Probably few applications behind after we're at Hatfield and Cook Ave first.
Okay. Realize you had your plate more than
couple
full.
Couple
more. Okay. Thank you. Any other questions? Actually, just another one for me. When the sidewalk inventory is complete, what form does the report come in? And it's just going to be a public report that's released this year, or will it be January?
It might be in January.
Okay.
Should be a report. Don't know the details, if it's public or not, though.
Okay. Might be appropriate. Can we take a look at it in this committee when it comes up? I mean, pedestrian,
sense.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Sidewalk recommendations, I think that makes
sense. Yeah. Okay. Great. Thank you very much. Any other departmental updates? If I can, actually, I'll just pause here and note that we have Devin Bruce back on this commission, so we all welcome her. Transportation Park Commission veteran who left for a while and is back now as the Planning Board representative. So welcome back and thank you. So, we'll launch into our agenda here, and the first one is, in fact, an ordinance, 16.184, an ordinance relative to operation of heavy vehicles. This would be to amend section 312.75 of the Code of Ordinances regarding restrictions on the use and operation of heavy commercial vehicles on certain streets, and regarding enforcement and for other purposes. So to begin a conversation on this, is there a motion to get this on the floor for recommendation?
Second.
made and seconded for a positive recommendation. And now let's discuss it first in the commission, then we can always open it up to the public for further comment before taking action. Since it comes from the Department of Public Works, I would like to ask if the DPW could give kind of an introduction to the ordinance from their perspective.
So, a few years back, this has been discussed where Lincoln Avenue is going to be a truck detour, and I guess Phillips Place as well. And
this makes me nervous.
I'm not quite sure the details of why Lincoln Avenue was a truck detour. If it's a residential area, why should trucks be allowed through that street? So I was just thinking, why not make it restricted in both ways? So Lincoln Avenue, North Street, and Bay Street would be restricted in both ways from truck access. Ordinance.
Okay. By the way, thank you. And there's no desire for me to read the entire text of the ordinance, is there? You can kind of explain it in plain English. And people have copies. But to explain the current state of affairs, there are two existing truck routes, truck escape routes, where truck traffic is not prohibited. One is Phillips Place. That is the case now. And the other is Lincoln Avenue. So however that came to be, that is the status of the ordinance now. And this ordinance, as our traffic engineer explains, would essentially reduce it to one escape route. And further, it would eliminate a section of the code, of this section of the code of ordinance, section C, which has to do with the way warnings and penalties are given out. And at our last meeting, the chief of police explained how that section of the ordinance was confusing and sort of made it harder to enforce, and kind of the opposite effect from what was intended. So this ordinance would remove that as well, keep the $300 fine if you go down a street you're not supposed to as a truck, but then give the police department latitude to enforce it however their officers saw fit. So that is the state of affairs, and that's what this ordinance would do. Are there other comments from the commission? Bruce?
So maybe I'm missing a piece of this, but the compression release, the sort of the Jake break, is something that I remember talking about in a previous life. And the issue on that was, how would we enforce that? That, you know, it takes some sort of record of the sound in order to present the ticket and reinforce it. So is that, I'm just looking at a piece of the ordinance here, and I'm just a little confused why that is in with the operational characteristics of the truck.
Yeah, I can answer that. That's a good question. For whatever reason, the title of this section 312.75, includes compression release engine brake use, because later in that section there is part of the ordinance that deals with that, and it's sort of questionable how enforceable that is,
okay,
or whether it's a matter of state law. But in any event, this ordinance does not amend that section.
Right. Thank you.
Well, I would love to hear, you know, from a public safety perspective, what we hope to accomplish by this. I think some of the conversation that's been had is centers around the philosophy that right now we have two escape routes. They exist. And the enforcement mechanism is a little unclear. So perhaps if there were just one, and the enforcement language were clarified, then the existing truck prohibitions would be easier to enforce if we made an investment in enforcement to do that. And I think another point is that, you know, if you have a truck escape route, I don't know, you sort of don't want it to be, you know, a first-class truck escape route. You know, you don't want it to be something that people, you don't want people to enjoy. You know, Lincoln Avenue is, frankly, trucks use Lincoln Avenue even when they don't make a mistake, in my opinion. I think if you get off the highway and you've legitimately made a wrong turn, you should have the opportunity to correct your path, obviously, for no other reason than you don't want to run into the truck-eating bridge. But it shouldn't be a matter of course. It shouldn't be a matter of routine operational behavior that you know about Lincoln Avenue and take it. Frankly, the other escape route, which again exists and is law, is much less convenient for truck drivers. And I think one thing I think would be great to discuss is the enforcement piece of this. If we were to make this change, how would the police department envision enforcing it, and what kind of changes to driver behavior could we expect?
Just to embellish upon what you just said, Ryan, I'd also like to discuss the whole notion of the encouragement piece. And once this becomes an ordinance de jure, how do we encourage people to do this? How do we monitor this to see that it's in fact working or not working? We need some sort of a method to, because of the critical nature of this issue. So we put it on the books. Chief of Police is now charged with enforcement. I think we also need to look at the whole monitoring piece moving forward. So I'll just throw that out there.
I appreciate that. Yeah. Chief, do you want to add?
Yeah, and so the language cleanup in here, removing the whole verbal section, would be very helpful for our officers. We have put officers out in this area before. We have tasked them with enforcement, and they typically talk to drivers who say that they're using it as an emergency route and that they didn't know. But when you hear that story every time, one begins to question if that is the case. And as you said, it's an easier route. So I think the thinking is if we get rid of the easiest route and make it kind of a pain to take the emergency route, there would be no incentive to do that. No truck wants to drive down the pictures that you showed. No one wants to drive down that route. So they would hopefully, in that sense, learn their lesson and actually get off the highway and go the right way next time. And certainly, from my perspective, we have heard a lot of concerns from residences of the area. So we are absolutely ready to build on having enforcement out there, a higher presence for everyone, and aggressively really talking with drivers. And removing this language doesn't mean that they can't be given verbal warnings. We have that discretionary power when we pull cars over anyway, but that officers would feel like no one could say to them, oh, it's an emergency route, and then not feel supported by the ordinance. So that's the thinking behind that. We can put officers out there who are ready, willing, and able to support this ordinance.
Not to be redundant, but not only is it not an easy route, they're gonna have to go back down Damon Road. So this what used to be a shortcut, which avoided Damon Road and going this way to get to Coke, they will now have to go and do that anyway. So there's sort of extra added disincentive to ever do it again.
The only downside I see is that as those trucks are traveling into town on Bridge Street, that gives them that statement that they can always say in other words, Phillips Place is the last before the bridge, so that whole section into town is now not certain that they are transgressing. I mean, you think they're not coming in on, you know, that it's not an emergency, but I just want to lament the fact that we are, it would be nice if we had a situation where enforcement could happen anywhere along that route into town, because that isn't where you want the trucks going. I have the same problem with trucks on the other side of the bridge. I have sat downtown and watched how many trucks come through the main intersection of town, and so I'm kind of interested in doing some sort of counts to see, because there's a lot. It's not just Coca-Cola, but I don't think large transfer trucks belong on Main Street. I mean, I would like for them not to. And I can't figure out why they aren't taking a different route, but it's the same thing we're talking about here. So not a change, it's just, I just want to state that it'd be, for enforcement, it'd be really nice if anywhere along that route into town, they were past the emergency escape route, because then it's clear that you can engage them and say, what are you doing here?
I think it's a fair point, and to provide a little bit of background, some of the thoughts I had and some limited conversation outside of the commission involved the idea of creating a no-truck zone. So in other words, as soon as you turn left, mistakenly, off of, say, exit 19, then everywhere in the downtown area would be a no-truck zone. So as you say, truck traffic would be prohibited on Bridge Street. And we toyed with it for a little bit, but actually our very astute traffic engineer pointed out that MassDOT has to approve every truck exclusion route, and one of the routes they will never approve is a numbered route. And so because Bridge Street is Route 9, that turned out to be not feasible. But I would also think, did you have comments?
Well, I was just gonna say, also something to keep in mind is that if that's the route that they have to go, we are bringing them past a school, which is something I think we would probably like to avoid if we could.
That's true. Mr. Albert.
Phillips, I mean, this picture sort of does illustrate it. Like, do we feel that we can keep Phillips clear in winter and wide enough for these trucks to get through?
Well, that's a question, I guess, for the DPW. again, the current state of affairs is that Phillips Place is a truck. I would also imagine that if we have two truck routes and a certain amount of trucks, I would almost imagine that if we eliminated, we went down to one, I don't necessarily feel that one truck route would experience double the truck traffic. It just seems, especially if we couple it with enforcement and the word gets out among frequent drivers in this area, I sort of would expect a combination of that thing. The goal is, I think we want a solution for the whole, this part of downtown, for all, it's mostly Ward 3. We want a solution for all of Ward 3. And I would think that these efforts combined would actually have the effect of reducing truck traffic. Mr. Pomerantz's point, you obviously have to monitor it to see if that actually is the reality. That would be my hope.
I think your truck escape route, and you sort of discussed this, should be sort of a disincentive for travel for these folks. So in terms of keeping the road clear, I think we can keep the road sort of minimally clear to get the truck through. But again, it will not be a luxurious route, and that really is by design.
Yeah, I think there's an advantage in not having the escape route the same thing as a shortcut.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's really all we're trying to do, I think, is get rid of, make it harder and change the enforcement language.
And as a side note, I would also acknowledge that the issues that Phillips Place has, principally the parking situation, is an important issue that can also be addressed. And I wouldn't want to say we're not going to try and improve the truck traffic in this part of the city, which is substantial, until we fix all the other problems on the related streets. I think we need to do both. Any other comments from the commission? And then I think a couple other people have walked in. I would like to give the public a chance to speak on this if anyone hasn't. We do that. Should we reopen public comment for a time? Yes, sir.
Yes, my name is Francisco Palomo, and I live at 42 Phillips Place. To your question of can the route be kept open, I say the answer is no. All right. I have lived at 42 Phillips Place I've lived on Phillips Place since 1982. I went from 37 to 42 a few years later. I've lost track, particularly in the winter. You have two things. You have the buildup of snowbanks on both sides of the street. And then secondly, Phillips Place has become the parking for people who work downtown. As the picture that Fred passed out indicate, in the winter, a car can barely get down the street, let alone a semi. More importantly, I don't know if the pictures that Fred passed out includes the intersection of Phillips and Pomeroy. Okay, yes, do you have it there? If you look closely at that telephone pole, first of all, several years ago, it was moved from closer to the corner about 2 feet down. In its current location, it is constantly being hit. All right, that picture probably doesn't do justice to it, but already at least a quarter inch of the pole has been whacked away by trucks smacking in it. I expect that any day now, some truck will knock that utility pole down. All right, so the current number of semis going down Phillips is a problem. In the winter, when there is snow, this last winter there wasn't very much snow. The previous winter, at least once a week, a truck was stuck. Could not make the turn from Phillips onto Pomeroy. The police had to come, they had tow trucks and stuff. It was a daily, or it was a weekly occurrence, if not daily. All right. If you close off Lincoln as an escape hatch for the trucks, at a minimum, the traffic will increase. It'll probably double, and we'll have an even bigger problem. So what you are suggesting is not workable. Now, I heard the comment about that you can't make Bridge Street a truck exclusion because it's a numbered road. However, it is impossible for a semi to traverse from the bridge through downtown because of the bridge that's there, that's too low. I'm sure that you can reason with the Department of Transportation pointing out that this could be the exception that proves the rule. It doesn't make any sense to allow any semi to go from the intersection of the bridge or Damon Road all the way down to downtown because it has nowhere to go. All right. There are no industries that require the delivery by a large semi along Bridge Street. All right. There is no reason for a semi to traverse that stretch of highway. I understand that this is a general rule, that a number of highway you don't make a truck exclusion, so on, but clearly, at a minimum, we should be contacting the Department of Transportation because it doesn't make any sense for any semi to traverse that. The most logical thing would be to enforce, pass an ordinance that basically says no semi can make a left turn off of exit 19, no semi once it crosses the bridge heading west must turn right onto Damon Road because there's no place for them to go. Now, I can empathize that people on Lincoln Avenue don't really want to have a lot of trucks passing down their street. However, Lincoln Avenue is twice as wide as Phillips. It is clearly, if you're going to have an escape hatch for semis that make the wrong turn, that is the logical place for them to go. All right. Anyway, that's my point. I vehemently oppose the ordinance as written, and if it means that the only escape hatch would be Phillips Place. And the only logical thing is that you should go back to DOT and talk about making Bridge Street a truck exclusion zone, because where would a semi be legitimately traveling down that street? And the only possible way you could make have more trucks coming down Phillips is if you institute some sort of parking ban. All right. Passing this ordinance without at the same time enforcing an on-street parking ban in Phillips Place, you're creating a recipe for disaster come winter. Because it just, like I said, once the snow comes in, people are parking on both sides of the street, a car can barely get down that street. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other members? Is there anyone who hasn't given public comment and would like to speak?
I'd just like to ask a couple questions, and that is, back in 2011, when I talked about the Phillips escape route, I suggested that Hancock Street would be the street to be used. And that went to the DPW, and they thought about it, and they came back, and they said, well, we'll move the utility pole, which was never moved. They wanted to move the utility pole across the street. But they never told me, or never mentioned, why Hancock Street could not be used. I have some more pictures here that I can show you. One shows Hancock Street in the winter. That curve is easily negotiable by a semi. And the other picture that I've taken shows the street during the winter. There's no parking there. Semi can make it down that street. So my question to you is, why isn't Hancock a usable escape route?
I mean, if, I suppose we could make it an escape route. My question and response would be, why are we trying to make it really easy for trucks to use the escape route?
Well, the other thing that I mentioned, apparently no one listened to me, and that was that in 2011, when I first proposed this Hancock Street escape ramp, we talked about a number of other escape routes, and one that was mentioned was the fairground. And Chief Russell Shankovich was there, and he said, no, you can't do that because trucks will be getting stuck climbing back up the hill in the winter, which indeed is a possibility. And when I did mention the situation at Pomeroy and Phillips, he said, that's a safety issue. That's a safety issue because you're blocking off three streets. If an ambulance or a fire truck has to get through, it ain't gonna happen because he's blocking three streets, William Street, Phillips Street, and Pomeroy. It's a safety issue. And the other thing is I'd like to ask Nancy what you told me about the situation when there's winter parking on Phillips Street. My understanding was that you said that I should contact you when I see that situation, and if you weren't available, I should contact DPW. Is that what you said?
And I'm sorry I jumped in before when you were
talking about that. No, that's fine. That was I'm in a learning curve here.
What I urge folks to do if they see a dangerous parking situation, if the parking office is open, you know, Monday through Friday, 8:30 to 4:30, please contact us. Never hesitate to contact us or the police department.
So in that situation, I would contact you.
Or the police department, you know, because they're 24/7 also. The DPW is always available to take calls to, you know, during the workday. There are a number of different offices that are available to you or to any citizen to call so that we can know that there's a situation to respond appropriately. Be it notifying the DPW that some assistance for removal of snow is necessary or whatever the case may be.
I mean, I seem to recall that you said the street would be closed, but apparently that's not true. So what would the action be taken if I did notify, say, police chief?
I'd have to have the police chief respond.
So what would you do when you saw the street clogged up like that? Those cars that obviously are illegally parked.
Right. We would send officers out and they would look at it. They'd write tickets to any cars that were parked illegally, and they would determine whether or not an emergency vehicle could fit through or fire truck.
Can't do it. I can just about get my car through. I went to the Northampton Fire Department. I asked them about their vehicles, and the officer that was there said, all vehicles in the Northampton Fire Department are 101 inches wide. And he said, he added that, you know, people hear that, and they say the hooked ladder's got to be wider, but it's not. They're all 8.4 feet wide, which means they're not getting through.
And just to keep the conversation focused, that's a problem that exists, according to what you're saying, independent of the trucks issue. That's a parking issue. Is that
true? True enough. It's okay. A parking issue, and a dangerous one too, I think, because you're going to have a senior center there with older people. They may need an ambulance, they may need a fire truck. So I think you really should think about Hancock Street as a possible route. And I never heard any answer from the DPW that it was not a reasonable alternative.
I can't speak to that. Are you arguing for the elimination of Phillips Place as a truck route? I mean, the testimony I've heard from Phillips Place would support that position.
Well, I think.
And that would be double traffic on Lincoln.
If you hear Maria's comments that she sent to the meeting, I think you'll understand what's going on, because she was city councilor when that legislation was put in place.
Okay.
The other thing I would like somebody to check is, are those warning lights from the laser detectors working properly? I think the answer is no. Somebody should test them. And I think they were put in by DOT.
Okay.
So Rick Massey or Seligman, I don't know what's going on.
I think it's very reasonable to look at the lights and see if they're functioning properly. I have no reason to believe they're not, but we could
verify. Well, I'm telling you, I see them flashing, there's no trouble.
I take you very seriously. So yeah, I see no reason why we wouldn't do that. I also think, you know, if we could make Bridge Street a truck prohibited route, with the exception of people making deliveries, because there are people, if you're going to trucks go to the post office all the time, for example, you want to exclude them. But I see no reason why we couldn't look into giving the police department the option, if they wanted, of giving a ticket on Bridge Street, if that were a useful part of an enforcement system. Mm-hmm. That seems to make sense.
I think my final comment is that this situation needs a little more thought. Thank you.
If I could just...
Is there anyone else who hasn't spoken who'd like to speak?
I'll just
yes, sir.
Take a second. My name is Mike Ivey, 69 Day Avenue. It's a kind of shame to feel like two neighborhoods are being a little bit pitted against each other here, because I completely agree with my friend here, Mr. Plumber from Phillips. both neighborhoods in a tough spot here, and being in the midst of it, 69 Day Avenue is right smack there where that three-way stop sign is. And all you gotta do is stand there any given day, and you would be shocked. First of all, you'd be shocked not on today's issue per se, but on just traffic and so on. The number of people that flow through that stop sign, and then the amount of truck traffic. And I can also see where it's really hard to imagine trucks navigating Phillips. So, you know, you've got, I guess, continued work to do, but we appreciate the work you're doing. It does need a solution, it's a mess. And I agree with Mr. Squires, and I feel really badly for the folks on Lincoln. Really badly, because I see those trucks make that corner and I say, here comes another one. And they've been through it down there. There's none of them here today, partly except for Mr. Squires, partly because I don't know, maybe they're burned out. And it's been a long process for that neighborhood down there. And the only other thing I say, great point about a Route 9 exclusion possibility with the state. That's probably going to take a long time to get through whatever hoops are associated with that. So some sort of a plan B in the meantime, and maybe more enforcement or something. I don't know, but I second that wise suggestion in terms of looking at the state, trying to create an exclusion to keep the trucks off Route 9. That'd be a home run. Thank you.
Thank you. Would you like to?
You asked the question of Shred, Mr. Thumbchuck, about if we would want to have Phillips closed as an exclusion zone, and I say yes. All right, because, like I said, I'm waiting for that utility pole to be knocked down. There's already chips on it, and the wire's running up the side. Every winter, that street gets blocked, and so it doesn't make any sense to use such a tiny, tiny street as a truck access route. The only way to make it work is if simultaneously with making this, you pass some sort of ban on on-street parking. Right now, you know, I mean, there's nothing to stop anybody from parking on Phillips, and it gets filled up every time.
Thank you very much. Mr. Kirby.
When I was a city councilor, and Mary Ford had just been elected, she and I went to Boston and to talk about something or other. And she said, she was very happy. She says, you know, the first thing I'm gonna do is fix this problem with the trucks hitting the bridge. It'll never happen again. So the other towns have managed to address these problems with dispatch in Green Worcester. And they did it with a variety of ways, drooping cables, flashing lights, whatever. But it's just that we seem to love talking about this problem but not moving ahead on it because of whatever reason, I don't know. You know, there always is a reason not to do something.
Thank you very much. Mrs. Wives.
I really think for a short term, Coca-Cola really needs to step up to the plate. Living on Lincoln Avenue, you see a lot of the repeat offenders coming through, common carriers like Swift, Trans Am, Martinique. So I think if Coca-Cola could
get in contact with these common carriers or repeater offenders coming through our street all the time. Maybe they can reduce some of this truck traffic. Because it is pretty much the same carriers that are going through. So I think they need to have a much better communication with the carriers that they're using. It could maybe, you know, eliminate some of this truck traffic.
I have to be honest with you, I mean, as a Day Avenue resident, you know, we're neighbors, I mean, I appreciate the sentiment, you know, with which you offer that suggestion. It's, I think it's an intelligent suggestion. But I mean, history seems to show that Coca-Cola is not as willing to listen to the needs of the neighborhood, perhaps, as we would wish them to be. And that would be my only concern, is unless we take action in the city to increase enforcement, which we stand ready to do, and to change an ordinance to facilitate increased enforcement.
No, I
that's why I bring it forward.
I mean, like I said numerous times, we requested meetings with Coca-Cola. And
and so me too. Yeah.
Nothing.
Yeah.
So I mean, you know, they want to be good neighbors. They say.
Yep. I completely agree.
We're going around and around.
Completely agree.
Thank you.
Thank you. I saw Jim's hand up.
So, Jim Nash, 18 Montview, Ward 3 City Councilor. So first of all, Maria Tomasco gave me something to read. She sent me something earlier. I think it's pertinent in terms of it helps frame the history of what has gone on. Let me give you a bit of background about the situation, because the escape routes were established soon after I became city councilor for Ward 3 in 1996. We had no routes till then, and trucks would come to the underpass, eyeball it, get stuck or decapitated, etc. Alternatively, they were wandering around the southern part of Ward 3 randomly. The obvious escape route is Lincoln Avenue. It's the widest side street along Route 9. I want to say these little remarks of Maria Tomasco. It has the easiest turning radius for long vehicles, and it returns trucks fastest to Damon Road. Of course, the neighbors dislike it, but what is the alternative? One I proposed was hanging chains off a metal arm at the effective height of the underpass that would hit the roofs of trucks if they were too tall to make it through, the sort of installation that exists on Storrow Drive in Boston for the same purpose. The DPW couldn't be bothered, made all sorts of excuses, as they did in those days, about speed bumps, etc. In the end, we settled on the escape routes that are currently indicated, figuring that a lot of the drivers would miss Lincoln and need a second chance. Obviously, this is the case because we have a lot of trucks circling back along the Pomeroy Terrace route. And we still have trucks hitting the overpass. I was a new councilor and didn't want to irritate my constituents, so I proposed the current arrangement of two chances. The obvious choice for the second route was Hawley to Hancock to Pomeroy Terrace, in part because part of Hancock is already marked as no parking. However, the current route down Phillips was chosen. Phillips has become even less suitable than it was at that time because under Mayor Higgins, the city stopped banning parking on city streets December through March, which also resulted in increased numbers of students living in units formerly inhabited by families and driving up real estate prices in the city. At present, the parking situation on Phillips makes it totally unsuitable. In addition, as the trucks get longer, more and more of them have to drive over the curbs to turn, threatening a fire hydrant, hitting the tree at the intersection, and hitting the telephone pole as well. This situation is very dangerous and will become more so if the route at Lincoln is eliminated. She sees a number of options, leave things as they are. She doesn't like that. Install the chain device, which she liked.
change the southern escape route to Hancock, better than the current situation. Get trucks off of Lincoln and leave the rest as is. She asked that I read this at City Council, and so I did that. I think what's really important for me here is the history, to understand how far back this goes, and that that this has been going on for a long time. The thing that has changed over the last decade has been the use of GPS. That what were once, you know, occasional trucks is now we have drivers who daily are using their GPS to get to Coca-Cola. If you plug in Coca-Cola or anywhere on Industrial Drive coming from the south or from Amherst, it will direct you to Day Avenue. So, and the trucks get to Day Avenue, they see the no truck sign, they go to the next available street, there's Lincoln. Hence, that's why there's now greater concern about the trucks. My concern with this plan is, number one, we don't have data on how many trucks are actually going up Phillips right now. So when the people from Phillips come back and say the trucks are worse, we have nothing to go and say, well, you're right or you're wrong, you're just eyeballing it. If the issue is that people are choosing to go this route, then this may solve it. Because you're right. It's not an ideal route to go down to Phillips and then go all the way back. But if you're following your GPS, as many of these drivers are, I've talked to them, we've all talked to them at different points. They're guys, usually that English is their second language. You can tell they haven't grown up around here. I'm sure the police will attest to this as well, that these are people who are new to the area. And these are the people we're gonna ticket. And that they get off those trucks and they're pointing at their phones or whatever's in the truck, and that's why they're there. They don't know that the ideal route is actually to go straight up Damon Road and then take that left. And the thing is, if we do this, and that personal choice is not the issue, but GPS, we are sending all of these trucks to Phillips Place. That's the problem. So that's why I'm asking to slow this all down a little bit. Let's look at the parking on Phillips Place. It's pretty terrible. Let's consider what that escape route needs to look like. It might need to be Hancock. Maybe it still is Phillips, but we can't be making it just Phillips and still have the GPS problem. Because in the winter, they're absolutely right. It's intolerable. We will have an even worse problem. So I campaigned on this. I want to take this on. I know it's a difficult problem. I know people are upset about it. And I'd like a chance to do my job around this and just slow this all down a little bit. I think that there's some other options we can explore. I think it's great that the police are ready to step forward and do some enforcement. I think it's great that we're ready to sign off on getting those trucks off of Lincoln. I think that we're, you know, in terms of coming up with a plan, we have a systematic problem. We have a trap for trucks, all right? And that we're just narrowing the trap, all right? Until we come up with ways to send trucks on their proper course, I think that we're just pushing the problem around the ward. And when I've spoken with neighbors, they're okay with an occasional somebody screwing up. But they're not okay with just having all of the trucks funneled right in. So the last thing is, I'm not going to support a plan that, you know, impacts one street and benefits another within my ward. I just can't do that. And I believe that we're going to find a solution on this if we can slow it down a little bit. So anyway, thank you.
Thank you. Is there any other comment? I really would like to.
Somebody else, by all means.
Well, you appear to be the only one, but feel free. And then I would like to.
I'm going to leave because decision. I'm supposed to leave at 5 o'clock.
I'm happy that you're going to speak. I just want to say that I'd like to move into.
Yeah. Before I came here, I was sitting down at the computer and I was thinking, and I typed the following words. I've watched the escape route issue for probably 10 years and attended two TPC meetings on the issue. When I think of the issue discussed, I'm reminded of Shakespeare and his witches. Double, double, toil and trouble, fire, burn, and cauldron bubbles. At which point the witches add their solutions to the cauldron. For example, the eye of a newt, toe of a frog, and maybe something else. I think most people I know have offered escape route problems. Few of them have any experience in solving traffic problems or see the entire problem. After all these years, I think I can conclude we are simply blind men throwing darts at the dartboard. It's time to consider reality. There are folks called traffic engineers that solve these problems for a living. They also know the secret of good problem solving, which is information. The city council needs to hire consulting traffic engineers from outside to gather information about traffic flow, current signage, truck driver issues, and more to come. The professional solution in order to keep the cauldron from boiling over and possibly adding too many frogs. I'm gonna go.
Exits in knock stage left. All right, I'd like to close the public comment at this stage unless there's anyone else, and then resume debate at the commission and then move forward one way or the other. So, okay with everybody? All right, so we're back in the commission now, and Councilor Sharon.
I want to talk to our traffic engineer that we have. I think that actually Councilor Nash has a good point that if we don't have data on Phillips, we don't have anything to compare to. Obviously, we have a long list of streets we're trying to collect data on. What's the feasibility of adding Phillips to that so that we could at least have a baseline for it? I think that would be a good idea.
The other thing is, if we did ever tackle the Route 9 state DOT, we would have to have those numbers to present to them. They're not going to take stories. They're going to look at traffic counts and the mix of heavy traffic in the traffic. So I think we have to, it's a step that needs to be done anyway.
There are legit trucks that need to drive on 9, though. The fairgrounds is the best example.
Yeah.
I mean, there's trucks that go down all the time, horses and rides and everything else. So that would be, there's no way for us to know when we see a truck where it's going.
Yeah. One other thing,
I
was on this committee when we put the exit light on the ramp off of 91, and I had great hopes that that was going to do something. So, and I called the mass planning office to get them to, you know, actually I told them the bridge was lower than it was, you know, and I've called Garmin and I've called, you know, so I want you to know that at least people have tried, and I agree with you, they're following their personal phones. There are commercial business tracking systems that would give them all of the height clearances and all of that, but that's not what they're using. They're using the, you know, Google turned into Next, and that's what they're using.
Is the proposal to do a traffic study this year, is that impossible with the weather counters?
I think at this point, I probably won't be putting in any more traffic counters because we did have snow in October, which was surprising to me, and trucks or plows over the bridge.
All right. I'd like to hear from the commission what action you would like to take. What is the commission most comfortable with at this point, Councilor?
I would like us to keep the part of the ordinance that allows the police department to do more enforcement or do it more easily. So I certainly would like that part to stay, or that part that's struck to stay.
One option is essentially to divide the ordinance and remove move adding Lincoln Avenue as a prohibited route. Yep, that is possible. Any other? So that's possible. We could vote up or down on a recommendation to the ordinance. What would happen then in terms of process? The City Council would refer it to one other committee, the Committee on Legislative Matters. There'll be plenty of other opportunities for public to weigh in. It would then work its way through the process. We could just delay it within this commission to a future meeting. Although, frankly, I'm just describing the options, so we could do that. I guess I see those three things. Can people speak to their preference about what they'd like to do?
My curiosity has piqued about the Hancock option, if it's already a no parking street and if it's for some reason better. I don't know in my own head, I can't recall what the street looks like. But I would be curious to table this and then at the next meeting have that. For me, that's a missing piece of information. So it prevents me from being able to make the best decision because I don't know if Hancock is better.
Okay.
I would agree with that.
Okay. It sounds like what we're talking about is continuing. Let's continue this matter to our next regular meeting. And I will request of the DPW if they would. Is there some way you can take a look at Hancock and make some kind of assessment, even if it's just sort of like a general assessment of how that might work? And it would also be a good idea to, if possible, talk to the Mass DOT about what might be done for Route 9. To add that as a prohibited route. And all these prohibited routes, they do make an exception if you are making deliveries within there. So if you're if you're moving, you're putting your stuff in a moving van or something, that's fine. Or if you're going to the post office, that's fine. It would make sense to maybe check it out if the DPW will.
Good answer.
I also would suggest that there are other things that we could do to improve the parking situation on Phillips in the sense of, could it be looked at as possibly for a neighborhood parking by permit only, like Kensington Avenue? And could we also look at, should parking be limited to one side as opposed to both sides?
Is that something you might be prepared to talk about at the next meeting as well? Mm-hmm. Councilor Shira, Mr. Pomeroy.
Again, would it be possible to separate out the enforcement part just so that we don't delay that further?
Yes.
The only thing I would mention is that if we are not removing Lincoln Ave as an escape route, then even if we take out that language, but we're still leaving it as an escape route, it would be not enforceable because everyone would say they're escaping.
But it would help you enforcing on other streets?
It would, yep.
I will say for the record that when the ordinance was written, it was written just for Lincoln Avenue to provide an additional penalty that didn't exist, a way to say you can't repeatedly use it. But if it's not workable, I'm happy to remove it. So that can be done. Before we do that, if I can just make a comment generally. I mean, I was the counselor for Ward 3 until this year. And this is a very old problem. And I live on Day Avenue. I see it personally. And the reality is we have two existing truck routes, and I think the fact is that there is no perfect solution to this problem. And I think we ought not to wait until we find one, because it's gonna be like a unicorn. We're gonna be searching for it, and we're not gonna find a perfect solution, and we're not gonna find one solution. As Ms. Bruce said, well, we put a laser-triggered light on the highway, and that was an excellent improvement. But that alone did not solve the problem. This alone won't solve the problem. And I think that at some point, we need to take action, even if it's not a perfect solution. And I actually appreciate Judge Goggins' comments about, we don't want to pit two neighborhoods together. And that's absolutely true. But the opposite of that would be, if we want to alleviate truck traffic, we would be creating perhaps more truck escape routes. If we created five of them, then in theory, they would all go down by a fifth. And of course, we don't want to do that because we want to be fair to everybody. But I strongly think that enforcement is the key to this. I think I support Councilor Shira's suggestion to take that part out of it. My hope was that if we had a truck escape route that was, frankly, like I said, not the first class truck escape route, but a difficult route for trucks to take, then coupled with enforcement, that would lower trucks throughout the ward, because ultimately it is true. I very much appreciate that sentiment. I thank members of the public who've said this. We need a citywide solution to this, or at least a ward-wide solution for this. But the status quo is not working, and we need to find some way to act on this immediately, as quickly as possible anyway, because I'm happy to wait for more data, but I've been in this commission for 3 years, and the problem exists, and we have not done all that we should do. So I hope that when we come back, we're ready to act, even if it's not an ideal solution. We need to try something, monitor the results, and see if it made a difference, because we owe it to the people who live there. We could just do nothing, because we can be frustrated by all the many different options before us. And for this problem, there are so many different things we could try. We gotta try something, measure the results, because the people who live on Phillips Place and Lincoln Avenue and everywhere in between deserve our action on this. And so that's my plea, and I have full confidence that with the data that we bring back to the next meeting, I think we'll be better prepared to do that. So that makes sense to me. And thank you to everyone for the discussion today. So, Councillor, are you making the motion to remove part of the ordinance?
Yes.
Okay.
So I guess I move to amend this first part, the box part, and keep section C as struck.
Does that sound like the way they read it?
Yep, so Councillor moves to essentially retain only striking section C of this ordinance. And I second that motion. Any discussion on the language change amendment? All in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Abstentions? Okay, it's amended. And is there any desire to put the Transportation Parking Commission at the top as a sponsor? You don't have to, but it's like perhaps it's not. Is there a motion for a positive recommendation on the ordinance as amended, which is only the enforcement piece and does not change the truck escape routes?
Mm-hmm.
Positive second. Recommendation, seconded. Any actually, it was already on the floor, actually. Anyway, any further discussion on a positive recommendation? Okay. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you very much. And we'll still revisit this plethora of issues at future meetings. Thank you to everyone who came. Well, that takes care of the first item on the agenda. We'll try and move swiftly through the other ones. 5B was enforcement of this issue, enforcement of commercial trucks restrictions, which we've already covered that. So we'll, unless there's any objection, we'll move on to 5C. There's no administrative ID number yet for this ordinance. This is an ordinance relative to school zones. I'm suggesting this after having had the idea sparked by our traffic engineer. And as you can see, what it does is, first of all, we have problems. We have separation of powers problems here. Pursuant to change in the charter. The current ordinance allows us to establish school zones, mentions entities that don't exist anymore, like the Board of Public Works. And it says if we want to establish a school zone, we have to refer to the school committee and various other things. And I think at the end of the day, in reality, the only body that needs to deal with the school zone by ordinance is the city council. It doesn't mean the other bodies can't weigh in if they wish, including the Transportation Parking Commission. But the first paragraph is struck for the reason that, you know, we don't want to have to refer these to commissions that don't exist and so forth. Section B, the language is just changed. It references Mass General Law, Chapter 85, Section 2, which allows us to establish school zones. As you can see, it kind of changed the descriptions a little bit. And then it also adds, and the point of that is to hopefully clarify the description. And then it adds, changed the name of what is now the Cutchins Program campus. And then finally, it adds another school zone. This is the creation of a school zone on Bates Street, where the Montessori school is. And I'm sure I don't have the correct measurements here, but I say from Norwalk Rail Trail to a point 150 feet north of the intersection of Bradford Street. We may have to change those numbers. And finally, section two, this is, again, this is, says standards for school zone signs and signals, and it says they must conform with the Massachusetts Manual of Uniform Traffic Control Devices. When, I mean, of course they should, so we don't have to have that in the ordinance. So it strikes that. So the long and short of it is the basic, the substantive change is it creates a school zone on Bates Street. As you may know, Montessori School is expanding. They're building a second building across the street. It's been for the planning board. I believe there'll be a new crosswalk, if I'm not mistaken. So two crosswalks in the area. So it meets the definition of a school zone or the criteria to be a school zone. And it would seem reasonable, you know, at that point in Bates Street, to when children are present, to reduce the speed to 20 miles an hour. So that's what that would do. I would love your comments on it.
It's an excellent idea.
Thank you.
Yes.
Wow. Seeing no other comments. Oh no, we should thank you, Councilor. You want to?
I move it for a positive recommendation.
Okay. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Thank you. Any further discussion?
Does the city get any money from Safe Routes to Schools? Safe Routes to Schools, it's a federal program that funnels money through the state, and I wonder if it ever gets to you. Just curious. Thanks.
I don't know.
That's a good question.
I could check with the school office and see if anything comes through there. It doesn't come through us.
Okay. It just might help to have one more. I mean, I'm with you. It's a good
just
idea.
Makes sense. Uh-huh.
Just one technical question about Bridge Street School. And we talked about this a little bit by email. There's no flashing light at Bridge Street School. Actually, Council Chair brought this up. You don't want trucks going by the school, and it's kind of a sensitive area. Children cross there all the time as well. People park there and get their kids. Is the reason why we don't have a flashing light there because in the current description of the school zone for Bridge Street School, Bridge Street itself is not part of it. As you can see, it says on Union Street to a point extending on Parsons Street, and Parsons Street to a point extending on Union Street, but there's no Bridge Street schools now. I'm wondering if we know why that might be.
Possibility. I'm not sure what Bridge Street is on there either, because I have seen school signs on Bridge Street. So does it make sense to add it at Bridge Street?
Yeah, it would seem to me. I mean, if that's the intent, to have the area in front of Bridge Street School be a school zone.
Right, I think if we have it in the ordinance, then we can consider school lights on Bridge Street.
And I think with the renovations to Lantern Park, which is abutting Bridge Street, there's a lot of crossover traffic now between people at the school using the park and vice versa. People at the park using the playground behind the school, so I think we could make the argument that putting that yellow light out there on Bridge Street would certainly make sense.
Yeah, and if I'm not mistaken, there are two signs in either direction that light up that sort of signal there's a curve. Have you ever noticed that? I think they stopped lighting up a long time ago. But it seems like there might be like the electronics in place or something. Anyway.
Well, is that the crosswalk where we had such a serious pedestrian event?
That was a little farther up. The next one up at Fair Street. Do you think it's since this is an advisory body only, I mean, can we incorporate into the recommendation the addition of Bridge Street with the understanding that the DPW will provide the correct measurements for the distance on Bridge Street?
That makes sense.
And then we can adopt them in the Legislative Matters Committee before the council, okay?
Sure.
And then also as part of the recommendation, if the DPW be willing to correct my shoddy work and give the appropriate measurements for the Montessori School, the Norwalk Rail Trail and so on. Okay. Ms. Chen.
Cutchins Program Campus, is that an actual? here, so it's a school, yeah. But does it still meet the requirements if we have any?
We actually have a board member of the Cushions program.
Should I put that hat on?
The Cushions program, it's a school.
It has a school, yes. It has a residential program and a school. So it probably qualified for having a school zone.
And what grades of children go there?
Kindergarten through high school.
Okay, so we're all set with that. Thank you, Counselor. Okay. Any other discussion on that recommendation?
Should other schools be included? I mean, we have a Smith Campus School, we have other schools that are for Adam,
oh, yeah.
I'm sorry.
That's true.
Right.
So which schools are we missing? Landon, Grinspoon, Prospect?
Smith Campus School and Smith Street.
What are the grades that qualify for schools?
They include, I think, first through eighth grade.
Okay. Missing any other?
So are you talking about the campus school, both ends? Are you talking about Prospect as well as State Street?
Yeah.
Right, we have to include both sides.
Is there any reason not to do that in terms of how it's laid out? Well, maybe given that observation.
I'm sorry, it has to go to eighth grade?
Less. You couldn't do it for the high school. For the sake of completeness, should we just bring this up next time with all the schools? Perhaps maybe we could be willing to. You created work for yourself. Okay. Well. Then why don't we, if you don't mind, can we change this to a motion to postpone to the next meeting? As much as I'd really like to do that. Jim, do you really want to say something?
Yeah.
Just kidding. You're welcome to, please.
The high school, I believe they have a Head Start program there. I don't know if that would qualify them.
That's a good question. Thank you.
Oh.
All right, well, so the motion is now one to postpone to the next meeting. Any discussion? All those in favor of the postponement, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you very much. All right. Signage within school zones, unless there's any objection, why don't we postpone that as well? Okay. Next is from Councilor Scherer. There's no number yet. An ordinance relative to parking on Center Street, Main Street, and Market Street to establish and remove 15-minute parking spaces.
I actually didn't get a copy of my ordinance in the packet, so can I borrow one? Oh, thank you. Okay. So, this is sort of like a packet of 15-minute spots. So the first one is Center Street. Now, you all remember that we removed the 15-minute spot right near the entrance to the police station. And actually, in our ordinance, we made the spot in front of it a 15-minute spot. That actually has never turned into a 15-minute spot. It's still, you know, a two-hour spot, I guess. So that change has never happened. In the meantime, I've heard from a lot of the residents who live on that street that they sorely miss the 15-minute spot that was there because they used to use it for unloading groceries. It's people who live on the other side of the street, in that kind of long building that goes to Maine, and many of them don't have parking spaces, and so they used to park in that spot and unload their groceries and then go park to wherever their long-term parking spot is. So they really miss that spot. They would like a 15-minute spot back. I said, oh great, there's one there in the ordinance, but it hasn't happened. And they said, well, you know, we all live on the other side of the street. We would love it if we could have it on that side. And since it actually hasn't happened yet, I thought, why don't we go ahead and change that, if everyone agrees, and create a 15-minute spot on this, the opposite side of the street. So I handed out some Google Map pictures. So see, there's this lonely, funny little spot between the curb cuts for the TD Bank parking lot. And that is my suggestion, is that we turn that one into a 15-minute spot instead. So So this ordinance, the first thing is it gets rid of that 15-minute spot that does not yet exist in front of the police station and changes it to that on the other side of the street. So that is the first one. The second one, if you turn the page, I've got two pictures. It takes us to Main Street, another spot that you all will remember, where we've just moved the bus stop that was more in front of where State meets Main and moved it farther down. And it's not so easy to see on these photos, but there are four spots in these photos, and I believe that we've now removed those two spots that are closer to Masonic. And so the idea is that we turn one of these two spots that still exist into a 15-minute spot. There are actually three restaurants that are on that block that might be able to use that for takeout and stuff. And then the third suggestion is another spot that you all will remember because we've talked about it a lot in the commission, which is the Market Street spot that we've talked about. And back in August, we sort of tabled it for a bit to say we were going to do some measurements, and nothing's really happened with it. And since I was suggesting the other ones, I thought I'd bring that one back. And the spot that I'm suggesting that we turn into 15-minute spot is this one that is right there and is in right behind where there's an entrance to a back kind of parking area. And I think we discussed in this commission that would be sort of a logical place for it. It would, if you remember, Click Workspace had originally asked for this spot. It's still quite close to Click, which is just a couple doors down, but it kind of adds ease for getting in and out of that spot. People are going to be getting in and out of it pretty regularly if it's 15 minutes long. So those are my suggestions, and I'd be happy to hear what everyone has to say. And I think Councilor O'Donnell will also talk to me about this quite a bit.
Do you want to get a motion on this for recommendation? A motion on this at all? And we can discuss it. I move to approve. I move for a positive recommendation, right?
So second.
Okay. And seconded, discussion on this ordinance. I support it. I think it makes sense on Center Street. I think it's a better location for a 15-minute spot. I think that would make sense. So it looks like it's ready-made for it, actually.
It seemed to me the old spot was somewhat in conjunction with the new police station. Do you think people were using it for that? Hard to say. Isn't it?
It's hard to say, yeah.
Relative to the other one, the one where the bus stop is, maybe I was confused. I kind of thought when we eliminated the bus stop, we might add a space where the bus was at the State Street side of that block.
I think we had some discussion and we weren't sure if there was space. I mean, great, okay. If we could add a space and then there would be three spaces there,
okay.
That would be great. But I don't know, I think we have to measure that.
Okay.
Unless.
It's due to the turn lane, we can put a block there. Cars are making the right, we wanted a space to get two up. So, as we've already taken away two spaces, it makes sense to change another space. Between the space and the from here. Essentially, this area will be have three spaces.
That's a valid point.
Yeah, I mean, I mentioned to the council chair offhand when I heard about the ordinance, and I just anecdotally, I was. Wait at the light at one point, and I saw someone parked illegally because they clearly needed to run in and grab some takeout. And I thought, well, if that is tying up the turning lane, maybe 15-minute space would be logical. But it was sort of me shooting from the hip. So I mean, if we're not comfortable making that recommendation on Main Street, I mean, it would be perfectly fine with me to remove that from this ordinance if that's okay with the sponsor.
Absolutely.
That might be simpler because if we need to really. Measure it and understand what we're doing. Maybe we can't do it at this point, so that'd be fine. And on Market Street, I can't remember exactly where it was requested, but is it close enough to other businesses? I mean, it seems like, you know, the roost on the corner would benefit from it.
I mean, it's a little bit far from the roost, but it's not so far.
I know that when the folks from Click were here, that they were very happy with that particular spot because a truck could easily get in back, you know, get into that area and get back into that spot without any kind of problems. And so it was a good delivery spot and a good location.
Where is Click? Is it across the street from that?
It's on the same spot, about a half block back, if less than half a block back.
In the picture, if you see sort of this longer bank of windows, that's where it is.
And there are no meters on Market Street now, is that right?
No, there are meters.
Towards Roost.
Mm-hmm. These are meters.
And then down towards this area.
To the extent that it's not filled with a car, it also gives you some sight line coming in and out of that alley. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So we're talking about supporting this, all but the Main Street one, right? And looking into whether or not we can squeeze a 15-minute in front of the Main Street spot. That's where we are.
Yeah, I'll just make a motion to strike the Main Street line.
Second.
Any discussion on that amendment? All in favor? That's gone. Okay. But my question is, if the Market Street one is the right space. I mean, I think that's the best space.
I mean, when I looked at it, that was my thought. It's the other spots are a bit tight, and there's a driveway and a home between where Sticks and Bricks and then that building that contains the Roost are. It's also kind of close to Main, and so you know that closest spot to Main Street. So kind of getting in and out of that when cars are coming through the light is kind of tough sometimes. I think it's what they've requested, and it does seem like it would be an easy spot to navigate.
So make sure there's utility for others besides the one business.
Oh, there's also a laundromat that's right there.
That's
so
true.
I don't know if people
go,
you know, drop stuff off and pick stuff up there.
Okay. It's really not such a long block. You can kind of walk to whatever.
It's really not.
Okay. Yeah. All right, any other discussion on the ordinance as amended? Just the two spaces. Okay, all those in favor of the positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you very much. I propose we skip item F because we've been kind of talking about it perennially. That's okay? Any objection to doing so? Okay. Item G is default speed limit in certain districts. I propose we largely skip this, but I would like to mention it. Under the Massachusetts legislature passed kind of an omnibus municipal modernization bill that has many different provisions in it that cities and towns cannot take advantage of. And one of them is the ability to, under certain circumstances, lower the default speed limit within thickly settled and business districts to 25 miles an hour. This commission is actually on record. I talked to the mayor about it, and he said, oh yeah, this is familiar because when I was on the Transportation Parking Commission, I being the mayor, they actually passed, or they wrote a letter in support of a state bill that would do this exact same thing on the theory that a lower default speed limit is just much, much safer for the public health. So I would just note that, you know, I've talked to DPW about this, and it's not as simple as flicking a switch, and we have to really be thoughtful about how to do this. But to put that on your radar, if you have any thoughts about how it might be implemented in Northampton, I think that's something actually we have to tackle at some point, because I'm already hearing about it from people who read it in the newspaper. And we should have a policy about how to implement it in the city. So just a note, unless anyone wants to say anything else, Ms. Chairman.
Just to clarify, this doesn't override existing speed limits?
That's right. Any unposted?
Unposted streets. And you could go by street by street, or you can do a blanket citywide ordinance, however, that's
difficult. Anything might be possible. We did discuss this, maybe a map showing where the thickly settled areas of the city are, which the law defines as 200 feet on average, structures 200 feet on average apart from each other.
I will
maybe planning can do it most easily. And the other possibility would be 100 feet apart, because that's actually what the state law that this commission backed said, 100 feet apart, so a denser residential area. Well, again, maybe planning is the right one. Yes, please.
So two thoughts. One is streets have a constructed design speed, so I don't want to be naive that we're going to change the speed and that's going to change the car.
Sure.
But on the flip side of that, the difference between 25 and 35 miles an hour for pedestrians is fatality.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, I think it's worth trying to do, but I don't think it will make a great deal.
Fair enough. Any other discussion on this for today? Any new business?
Just 2 points, Councilor. One is just a brief update on the LED streetlight conversion program. I know Karen, you brought this up last time. Mm-hmm. The city's converting 2,100 streetlights. Right now, Siemens is at the 40% mark, so about 900 and something. And Chris Mason has received 3 emails requesting that either a cul-de-sac or a total shield be looked at. So 3 out of 900 conversions so far. And Siemens expects to be done probably in about another 3 weeks for doing the conversions. Second item, I don't want to reopen the whole truck escape issue, but I was sitting here thinking, and I'd like to ask and suggest for the DPW, while we're working through collecting data, it is almost the end of November, if we do get snow, could we focus on making sure that Phillips and Lincoln are really knocked down with the snow banks and as clear as we can make them while we're working through this, to give them a little bit of assistance. So if it was July, I wouldn't be asking Donna.
So, thank you very much for both those things. Thank you. Any other new business? Is there a motion to adjourn? Oh, I'm sorry.
Not new business, but going back to the 15-minute parking spaces.
Yeah, it was
the measurements.
Yeah, I realized I didn't note that. I was going to talk to you after. Yeah, there are no measurements in there. I wasn't even going to take a stab at it. Would you be able to?
You're not doing it.
Boldly ask.
Go ahead. That'd be cool if you could.
Thank you.
Do we have any extra measuring wheels?
Yeah, I could just keep them in our cars.
That's one way to stop ordinances. Thank you very much. Okay, motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.